There's one penciled for Santa Maria, California, which is kind of, it's not really central, it's still southern, but it's northern southern coast.
You had me worried when you said Frisco. I thought you were going to, you know, say in San Francisco, and I was like, "Oh, people are going to be mad."
No, yeah.
Nope. Go Niners. Anyway,
This video is brought to you by LastPass. We'll hear more about them later. For now, let's get on to today's video.
Welcome to Room 6, the channel dedicated to local music and the people that make it, including my guests. And my guests today, something a little different. Normally, I interview acts, I review shows, I do live streams, and this time, I am reviewing something very special. I'm reviewing the future of music. I have here two gentlemen who are basically doing everything they can to get kids into performing music. Not just into appreciating it, but into performing it. So I really am so very thankful today to add them to the Room 6 family. Please welcome to the channel Don and Chris from Rock Stars of Tomorrow. Say hi, guys.
What's up?
Hi.
How's it going?
Cool. All right, thanks. Just kidding. So Rock Stars of Tomorrow, if you don't know who they are, first of all, if you don't know what Rock Stars of Tomorrow is, thank you for watching. I appreciate you. Go ahead and introduce yourselves properly and tell them like who you are, what you do, and what Rock Stars of Tomorrow is basically all about.
All right. You want to go first?
Sure, I'll go first. Okay, my name's Don Miskelin, and I am the owner of Rock Stars of Tomorrow Las Vegas. We are the first location in Nevada. Rock Stars of Tomorrow is a franchise that was born in Norco, California, about 15 years ago, and I have another location in Riverside, California. There are, I think, 14 locations across the country now. There's some in Texas. We just signed some new ones in Indiana this week that I've heard,
nice.
Also in Louisiana. So we are growing. We are a music academy because we do more than just music school type stuff. We do teach lessons. We have band programs that come out of those lessons. We do recording and production. We basically, when people ask me what I do, I say, we teach kids how to play music, we put them in bands, and we promote the bands around the community. And that's what we do. It's a great business to be in. It's a lot of fun. It's inspiring. And I love what I do.
And I can tell, like, you probably have seen already some B-rolls and B-shots that I took. This place is decked out to the nines. It's every musician's dream. Every single rehearsal room, they've got a green room. They've got this place we're sitting in, which is a venue, a proper venue with a proper stage and lighting and everything. You probably even hear the fans from some of the lighting. I'm jealous. I'm deeply jealous that I didn't have this when I was growing up.
Do you know how often we hear that?
Yeah. I'm like... If my kid was here, I'd be like, you better freaking go to every lesson. You know, you better be great. No, just
where was this when I was 15?
Yep. So, Don, you're the owner. Mm-hmm. And Chris, you're the...
studio manager.
Studio manager. I was going to say store manager. He sells the merch.
No, yeah, that's it.
And how long have you two been working together?
I started at the Riverside location, so our sister store.
Right.
What, about 5 years ago?
5 years ago.
Yeah. So I started as an instructor. I played in bands with Don's son growing up. You know, we learned music together. We played our first covers together, playing System of a Down and nice. All kinds of stuff. And, you know, I was working really boring, dead-end jobs, working warehouse construction, all the stuff that you don't want to do. And Shane, his son, actually hit me up and said, hey, my dad's opening up a music studio and he's looking for instructors. And
right on.
I'm like, that sounds cool.
Yeah.
And when I walked in, same thing you just talked about. It's like, I'm like, holy crap, where was this when I was a kid? You know? And it was cool. And luckily, obviously I got the job. And I've been doing instructing for the last 5 years or so until last year. You know, when they decided to open this place, they tapped me on the shoulder to come be the studio manager, which is like you know, a dream come true, you know.
Right on. I was researching this, you know, for the interview, and your bio on the website made it seem like almost, it's definitely mentioned Riverside or California, and I was like, wait, so is he bouncing back and forth, or is
No, I moved here November of 2022.
Okay. So you're not a native yet.
I don't know how long that takes.
10 years.
Do I need a tattoo or something?
When you've lived here 10 years.
Okay.
You're native.
All right.
Right on. By the way, if you want to be like them, be on the channel, whether reviewed, interviewed, or both, hit me up using my email address down in the description, or click the Room 6 social media link. That's going to tell you all the things I'm up to online, how you can support the channel should you so choose, and, you know, where else you can find me. And while you're at it, go ahead and feel free to like, share, subscribe, all the YouTube things. Thanks. By the way, if you want to know more about Rockstars of Tomorrow, I've put their link down in the description. It's rockstarsoftomorrow.com. And if you're not in Vegas, then there's one near you, most likely. And it sounds like there's going to be one opening soon.
In Indiana, they just signed that one. Right. So it's probably about a year out. There's a couple of them in the Dallas area. One's in Mansfield. One is in Frisco, Texas. There's one in Yomo, Louisiana. In Southern California, there's about 8 of them.
But none in Northern California?
None in Northern California yet.
Huh. I think there's a central one that was... Did they open
one? It's not open yet. There's one penciled for Santa Maria, California, which is kind of, it's not really central, it's still southern, but it's northern southern coast.
You had me worried when you said Frisco. I thought you were going to, you know, say in San Francisco, and I was like, oh, people are going to be mad.
No. Yeah. Nope.
Go Niners. Anyway, so just so we get it all, like, everybody on the same page, what exactly do you offer here in terms of lessons?
So let's let Chris do that.
Yeah. Well, obviously we offer the basic like rock and roll instruments for the most part, right? Mm-hmm. Guitar, bass, drums, vocals, keys. But our biggest thing is getting people in bands and doing those lessons, right? When you get in a band, the one thing it really does is it forces you to practice, because you don't want to show up and be the only person in that band that doesn't know the song, because then you have 4 or 5 people looking at you like, dude, what are you doing?
We've talked about it on this channel before, and I've even made a separate video of it. Don't learn your part at practice, at rehearsal. Practice at home, and then you come in and you figure out how it all matches together. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's a big thing, you know. It's one thing to play along to a song, but when you're showing up every week and there's a band relying on you pick up that instrument and you play those songs and you practice them.
They're going to let you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that's a big part of it. Another thing that we do is we have a studio here, so we record, we can record bands. We also teach that if anybody's ever interested in recording production, knowing what it takes to do that.
Oh, wow.
We have instructors that do that as well. So it's everything from the start of picking up your guitar for the first time and learning the basics, how to tune and all that stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
All the way through to being in a band, to even recording and putting out music.
Sounds like you're a one-stop shop.
That's
all things music.
That's it.
You can use that. That's free.
Yep.
Now, this location is located, I've got the address on screen. It's 301, I believe. 310? It's the address?
1181.
1181, and we're suite 130.
There it is.
That's what it was. Yeah.
1181 Buffalo.
South Buffalo.
Yes. So
Suite 130.
Basically Buffalo and Charleston. And I was surprised that you're way out here and not more central Vegas or in Henderson or Summerlin.
Yeah, we did a lot of searching. We actually have, so there's a family that's in Summerlin, and their kids have been playing music and they've been in bands for a while. Their cousins are at our Rockstars Riverside location.
Ah.
They came down for a show and they said, you need to put one of these in Vegas. So we talked to them a lot, and they kind of guided us on where to be. Vegas is a big place. Mm-hmm. People not from here don't realize how huge this valley is and how many people are here. And the plan is ultimately that we're gonna have 3 or 4 in the valley. This is just the first one. So we came here first. We might go to Henderson next. We might go to Centennial. I don't know yet. We got to see how things play out. But, you know, this is the first one. This is, out of all the Rockstars locations, when you walk into one, you know you're walking into a Rockstars. They all look like this. The decor is very similar, but this one, I have a business partner. His name's Tommy. He's not here today. He's actually at the Riverside location. But when we decided to do Vegas, we said, hey, if we're doing Vegas, we got to do big. Mm-hmm. This has to be the premier Rockstars. When the CEO, founder of Rockstars came to this location right before we opened, right before our grand opening, walking down the halls, I saw tears running down his face.
We
hit it.
Yeah.
Better than anybody else has thus far. People are gunning for us, but right now this is the premier Rockstars location in the country.
Wow. Well, I think the cool thing is they can see how far you can take this thing, right?
Yeah.
The flagship one in Norco is awesome. Really cool spot, right? And like you said, all the Rockstars are cool. They have the same look. But you know, we had to take it to that next level. And when you walk in this one, there's that little bit extra of things, certain things that we've done that now the other locations are going, ooh, I think we can do that, right? Which is cool because it just ups everybody's game and it makes everybody better, right? It's the same thing as playing with a musician who's better than you. You're going to get better because you're like, oh, crap, I can't go there and suck. I got to be good.
it's the one that's opening. In fact, they're doing a grand opening next week in Mansfield, Texas. And I've toured that location, and I walked into their recording studio and went, oh, my God.
How much for an hour?
I'm looking at the gear that's in that place, and the owner, Arnie Newman, is an amazing player, and he's been in the recording end of it forever. Mm-hmm. And he really did that recording studio up right. His place is very, very nice.
Right on.
So your recording studio here, is it available if, just some band wants to come record?
Yep.
Yeah.
Right on. Studio time.
Do you have is it just a standard flat rate, or do you have packages?
Yeah, so we do an hourly rate, $85 an hour.
Wow, that's really reasonable.
That comes with the engineer, right, and everything. So it is reasonable, especially if you go shop some of the places here in Vegas. Yeah.
The only thing more reasonable was my bass player at the time was my engineer and did it out of his home, which he had built out. It cost me like credits.
Yeah.
And he drummed on one of my albums. So I was like, thanks. Yeah. Shout out, BJ. Wish you were here.
There you go.
Stick around. We're going to hear some more from them. This is a little different. Like I said, I'm not asking my usual interview questions because a lot of them are focused around, you know, the band or whatever. But stick around. We're going to hear a quick message from Future Josh, and then we'll be right back.
And now, a word from our sponsors.
Thanks, Josh from the past. Want to know a universal truth? Passwords are a pain. Want to know another one? Having only one password makes everything a lot easier. That's what I use, LastPass, to secure my online presence. LastPass is like autopilot for all your passwords, giving you peace of mind wherever you go online. With over 33 million people using it and plans ranging from free to $4 a month, it's a great way to secure your privacy and save you time and frustration and hassle trying to remember which password goes where. Just for watching this video and for being part of Room 6, and for a limited time, you can use my affiliate link down in the description to get a Teams subscription for only $4 a month. Plus, you'll be helping out the channel. Thanks to LastPass for being a sponsor, and let's get back to today's show.
We're back, and if that sponsor spot interested you at all, please consider clicking the link down in the description. You'll save some money. I'll get some money. It's a win-win, baby. Now, for those of you just joining us, what are you doing jumping in the middle of a video? I've got Don and Chris here from Rockstars of Tomorrow, an amazing one-stop shop, all bells and whistles, music academy geared towards getting kids in bands and just, you know, get them out there and grow the future of rock. What do you have coming up here in the future that they should know about?
Well, we've launched a musical theater program.
Wow.
Believe it or not.
I believe it.
Yeah. So our first show is going to be Rock of Ages, which is going to be the first week in June. We're going to have 8 shows over 2 weekends. We've got some amazing people that are running those. We've got Levi Walker, who is set director for Chris Angel.
Oh.
He's going to direct this show. And then we've got Tracy Correa, who she was the, she's going to choreograph it. And she was one of the directors for Aida when it had its residency on the Strip. She is also, both of them were in the cast of Rent original on Broadway. And Tracy was also in the original Tommy on Broadway.
So you got people with pedigrees.
We got heavy hitters coming in to run this program.
I know you're doing auditions before this interview will post, but do you know what's next on the calendar for productions that people can audition for coming up?
You know, we're probably going to do Nightmare Before Christmas, which will be, it'll be just after Halloween and before Christmas is when the shows are going to happen. Yeah. So we'll probably have those, the announcements for that will be coming out probably in July, and then auditions, I would imagine, probably about August.
Okay. So definitely go to rockstarsoftomorrow.com so you can keep up to date with what all that and where you can see these performances. Although the musical theater is not going to be here, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we'll be,
we're going to do it in this spot. Yeah.
Going to get a curtain?
We are going to, we're going to do some additions.
Okay.
Yes. We're working on it.
You gotta have
curtains. We're working on it. Yep.
Right on. A couple more questions, and then we're gonna see kind of a sizzle reel, promo highlight reel from Rockstars Tomorrow. And I really sincerely hope that if you're at all interested, or you know somebody interested in getting into music, or getting better at music, or just need a studio spot that's a great price, you hit them up and tell them Room 6 sent you.
Ching.
I'm so cheesy. I'm going to ask one of my usual interview questions and see how this goes, because you obviously, you've been in bands before.
Yes.
I know you play music because he was jamming when I got here.
This is a question I usually ask at the beginning, and it's a question I've asked of all my prey. What is that earliest musical influence that made you say, I want to do that?
Ooh. Well, for me, I grew up in a musical family. My dad's side was all musical. My uncles play guitar, sing. My dad sings. My grandma, my aunts, everybody sings on my dad's side, right? And I remember my uncles and my dad were in a group. They called it Acoustic Breeze. And and they would do all kinds of cool covers. And one of the bands, though, that they would play that really got me was the Eagles. The Eagles that's one of my favorites, especially, you know, like in growing up in a family of singers, the Eagles.
And the harmonies.
The harmonies, man. Like all of that stuff just grabbed me. And me and my cousins, it was funny because we'd go to shows and we were little kids and we'd know all the songs, right? We'd be singing along to everything. And there'd be people in the crowd like, how do these kids know these songs? It's like, I literally grew up on all that stuff. So
the thing now is to see that those little kids at like a metal show in the pit,
yeah,
you know, and they're just totally going for it. And you're just like, on the one hand, I'm really impressed, but on the other hand, where's your parents?
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe this is the, let's get all the energy out now, little Johnny, and then we'll go
there
home.
You go. Yeah.
How about you?
So
mine goes way back.
He was in the Eagles.
Yeah. I'm a little younger than those guys, but not a lot.
Yeah, right.
So same kind of thing. My grandfather was a mandolin player, and he was actually renowned. He was on the Tonight Show with I can't remember. I'm drawing a blank on the name. Before Johnny Carson.
Oh.
And he played.
Not Dick Clark. I know who you mean.
Yeah, was it Steve Allen?
I won't be able to answer
think
that.
So?
Anyways, my grandfather played The Flight of the Bumblebee.
Wow.
On the mandolin behind his head.
That's got to be a Guinness World Record.
They said at the time he was the fastest mandolin player on the planet. So, my dad wasn't a musician, but grandpa always pushed it. And at about 5 years old, I remember standing in the living room at my grandparents' house playing the accordion.
Okay.
Playing the Marine Corps hymn on the accordion. So that was this big.
that was as big as you.
Yeah. I started playing drums in junior high. And then I think I was in eighth grade and I heard Eruption.
Tell me you didn't try to learn it on accordion.
No. I was the accordion was long gone by then.
I mean, again, impressive, but where's your parents?
Yeah. But I heard that song and it just hooked me, and you know, I wanted to play guitar. You know, I could never play like Eddie. I wish, that hooked me, and I started playing in bands, and then in high school and stuff like that, and went through all of that. But I remember the first time that I was completely just, my face was melted. And mm-hmm. I listened to Sabbath and stuff before that, but when I heard that one song, it was like, oh my God, this is,
you can do that.
Yeah.
And yeah. I'm gonna date myself. I think I was maybe 5 or 6, jumping on the couch for some reason. My older brother is 9 years older than me. Mm-hmm. He's playing Kiss. I don't remember which album. I think it was one of the.
That's one of his bands.
That was my
dude.
first concert.
I think it was Kiss Live, but I don't know. But I do remember, that's my earliest musical moment. But my first moment of actually, I want to do that, was in college. Long Distance Girl, and suddenly it was just like, and also MTV and VH1 were like really coming into prominence, and it was just like, oh, I can do that. I'm sure I had a VCR, yeah. And I VCR'd all the videos that maybe, like, you see, kids, there used to be these things called VCR tapes, and you had to know when something's going to come on.
And MTV didn't used to play reality shows.
Yeah.
They played music.
Yeah. It's low-hanging fruit to complain about that, but yeah. Yeah, you see, kids, people used to not care who was pregnant. Anyway.
Yeah.
So, right on. I have one more question for you. It's another one I ask of all my prey. And there's a little different slant on things than I normally do. We're going to circle back to that earliest musical influence question and say, look, we're going to talk to the children, which seems appropriate for this one. Okay? What we're doing is, let's go talk to little you. Okay? We're going to jump in a time machine. We're going to go talk to little you. What is one thing that you wish you could say, hey, you're going to need to know this, and don't say change of strings?
Ooh, there's so much.
But what's one thing that you're like, man, I wish I had known that, because it would have made XYZ simpler, or I would have been so much further along, or you know?
I think music theory, when I was a kid, I just wanted to learn songs.
Yeah,
I
want
to learn songs. I want to learn that song. How does that song go? And for me, it became the numbers thing. All right, fifth fret.
Tabs.
And it was tabs.
Yeah.
And, you know, that hindered my progress as far as being a true musician, because I didn't know how music was put together. I knew a song. I didn't know what key it was in. I didn't know any of the stuff you need to know if you really want to jam with musicians, right? Mm-hmm. And so it took me years to realize, like, oh, maybe I should learn theory, you know, at the very least basic theory.
Right.
So that was something that I wish I would have actually been able to say, hey, you need to do that, even though it's the boring stuff, right?
Right.
But it's really important, you know. I always tell kids that learning your notes and learning all that stuff, that's learning, it really is the alphabet, right? It's the musical alphabet. You can't just write a sentence with the alphabet unless you know how to put them together, and you should know how it works, right? You have to know all that stuff in order to make a sentence, and then you can make a few sentences and form a paragraph, and now all of a sudden you have something that makes sense, and when somebody reads it, they're like, oh, this makes sense.
Right.
But I didn't want to learn that stuff.
You can't break the rule or bend the rules until you've learned the rules.
Yeah.
Yeah. How about you?
I agree with Chris on that, but I'll take it a step further.
No copycats.
In that, I would have told myself, because when I first started playing in bands, it was like I was playing in like junior high marching band kind of stuff, playing the drums, and I got hit up to play bass at a junior high battle of the bands.
Nice.
And at that moment, I learned about, you know, white tight pants and the image and getting chicks.
Yeah.
So instead of like the nerdy guitar players who would spend weeks in their room practicing, I was being cool. You know, I knew my power chords.
He was such a bass player.
I could, but then I switched to guitar, but I knew my power chords and I could stand right and I could wear the right clothes and I could do these big, huge chords and stuff like that. And it was bitching.
You're giving me PTSD. I would tell myself,
talking to young me, don't do that. Go in your room like the nerds and really practice and learn that stuff. And maybe someday you can play Eruption.
And then it'll be really bitching.
Yes.
Yes. There's time for fun, but it's more fun when you have the work put in. And yeah. I have a 16-year-old, and I threw lessons at them. And it's, no, at the same time, every day it's singing and it's dancing around. And you're just like, you could be so, but you can't. You have to step back and be like, you know. Yep. All right, well, you know, whatever. And now they've got their own direction they're going in there with art and other things that I can't teach them. Mm-hmm. You know, thing where I'm just like, geophysicist, okay. I'll pay for it. Yeah. So, right on. It's funny you say that about the bass. Like, so many people have come on this show and been like, well, they needed a bass player, so I learned how to play. And it was bitching. In almost 5 years of doing this, no one's ever said that line. That's awesome. Thank you. Well, thank you very much for watching. Thank you, gentlemen, for being on the channel. Stick around. We're going to see that promo highlight reel for Rock Stars of Tomorrow, and then we'll catch you in the outro. In the meantime, temporarily say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Temporarily. See you in a bit.
Definitely say I got a lot of experience from it.
It was pretty great. It was really fun. It really helped me get more confident in singing in front of a crowd.
I had a lot of fun with it. It's, I think, my third time doing it, so it's pretty fun.
Well, I'm pretty ready. I do sometimes get nervous when I was like earlier in playing performances, but now where we are today, I'm pretty confident.
I feel pretty ready. This is actually my second time playing here. I play guitar and bass.
I feel pretty good about it. I think I've got like my songs down and everything. Yeah, I just gotta get ready, like, mentally.
Honestly, if you really want to play in a band just like as soon as possible and meet new people, I would say join just the Bangor program. You can play basically whatever you want, which is I found really interesting.
If you're gonna start something, go on through with it. Don't just quit right away. If you want to like try to play an instrument or something, just give it your best.
It's not late to learn an instrument. You can always learn one, no matter what age.
Yeah, keep up the work. If you're dedicated to an instrument, you can practice to it, you'll definitely get better.
I want to thank Don and Chris from Rock Stars of Tomorrow for coming on the channel. It was a great interview and an awesome highlight reel. You definitely need to check this place out. It's amazing. Wherever you are, check out Rock Stars of Tomorrow. You'll just be gobsmacked like I was when I walked in. In the meantime, definitely hit those links down in the description for them. And if you want to see more videos like this, please click up here. If you want to subscribe, click over there. Ring the bell, all those YouTube things. And if you want to hear my own music, click over there. Remember to be amazing, and we'll see you next time on Room 6. Say goodbye again.
See ya.
Goodbye.
Ba-da-ba-ba-da-ba.